Thanks very much. I'm Steve Simpson from the Institute for Justice. I'll be moderating the panel. As with the previous panels, we will have initial remarks for approximately 15 or 20 minutes, and then afterwards a little bit of exchange among the panelists, and then we'll open it up for questions. So that's our panel, and we can kick it off starting with Clark. Thanks.
Well, we've got to the point in the symposium when if there's a disaster, it's going to be because of something that I or one of my fellow panelists does, so I think it's appropriate to take a moment and thank the three people who are most responsible for pulling this off, my colleague Elizabeth Price Foley, Steve Simpson, and really, most importantly, Chrissy, if she'll come in here, because everything that went right today was because Chrissy was in the background making it go right, so if we could give them a hand real quickly. Just before Christmas in 2010, outgoing Senator Arlen Specter and the association with Christmas seems like it was a present to many of us. When Arlen Specter left the Senate, he said that the Supreme Court has, quote, been eating Congress's lunch by invalidating legislation with judicial activism. As Sandy Levinson mentioned and others have mentioned, Doug, we decided to test this empirically, and so we counted up the number of laws, federal laws, that had been passed between 1954 and 2002, which was the last year we could get a count. And then we wanted to compare that with how many times the Supreme Court struck down federal laws, and the count was this: 15,817 federal laws passed, 103 strikedowns, two-thirds of 1%. That's not Congress's lunch. That's not even the crumbs from Congress's $4 trillion a year table. And that's judicial activism? I think not. The framers thought that federalism would be such an important protection for individual liberty, as Justice Kennedy reminded us in Bond, that they didn't even think we needed a Bill of Rights, because the number of things that Congress would be prohibited from doing by virtue of not having those powers enumerated would be so large that society would be like, as Randy reminds us, a large ocean of liberty with little islands of government power. Can anybody tell me all of the things that Congress can't make you do pursuant to the doctrine of unenumerated powers? It should be pretty easy. There are only two: carry a gun within 1,000 feet of a school, and be hailed into federal court for civil damages for a tort of domestic violence. That's it. That is what has become of the doctrine of federalism the primary protection of liberty in the original Constitution. That is not restraint. That is a one-way ratchet in favor of more and more and more government power. In 2005, the Supreme Court rewrote the Fifth Amendment to replace the public use provision with public purpose. And it then stretched this new provision to enable the city of New London to take private homes and businesses in the neighborhood of Fort Trumbull and give them to a private property developer on the hope, the false hope, as it turns out, that that developer might build a yuppieville for Pfizer that would bring in more tax revenue and create jobs. In rewriting the Fifth Amendment to the Constitution, the Supreme Court did to property rights what that private developer would later do to the Fort Trumbull neighborhood with bulldozers. And that was done under the banner of judicial restraint. The Constitution is a charter of liberty. It provides for about this much government. We have so much government today that my arms are not long enough to illustrate it. How did that happen? Well, it happened because we allowed judicial restraint to become judicial abdication. That's where we are today. And judicial engagement proposes a very simple, very modest remedy for this. And I hasten to emphasize just how modest it is. It is not activism, it is only this. What judges do in cases involving constitutional values that they care about, let them do in all constitutional cases. And by this we simply mean judge. Real judging, sincere judging, genuine engaged judging that seeks to evaluate the government's actual ends, to assess the legitimacy of those ends, and refuses to accept hypothetical, invented, and not to put too fine a point on it, false justifications for the government's conduct, and refuses to accept as true factual assertions for which the government can offer no evidence. By the way, just as courts refuse to accept as true facts or evidence or factual assertions for which any other party can offer no evidence. What judicial engagement asks court to do is to take text seriously, whether it's the public use provision of the Fifth Amendment, the Ninth and Tenth Amendments, or the Privileges and Immunities Clause of the 14th Amendment. It asks government to candidly evaluate the government's true ends. And when those ends are illegitimate, as they sometimes are, then say so. Do not merely bury your head in the sand, however deep you need to, in order to be blind to the reality of what the government is doing. And as I said a moment ago, don't invent justifications for what the government is doing. That violates a basic precept of procedural due process because it puts the judges actively on the side of government in litigation. Judges are literally commanded to help the government win rational basis cases by helping the government think of justifications for laws that have been challenged that did not occur to the government. And courts actually do this. Just this term, in a case before the US Supreme Court, Armour v. City of Indianapolis, the Indianapolis Supreme Court literally invented a justification for the City of Indianapolis's unequal taxation of citizens in the City of Indianapolis to pay for sewer hookups. That is not judging. That is collaboration. And it is a violation, a very serious violation of due process. But under rational basis review, it's business as usual. And again, that's not judging. It's certainly not judicial engagement. That is abdication. What we euphemistically call judicial restraint has gone far beyond a healthy humility and all too often constitutes make-believe judging, pretend judging, judging in which courts simply go through the motions of adjudicating a case while reaching a result that is effectively predetermined because of the standard of review that the court is applying. Often rational basis review, but not always. Let's take a look at make-believe judging through the lens of a constitutional claim that IJ frequently brings. I've litigated in this area, as have many of my colleagues, and we've heard about it earlier today, the right to earn a living. The right to earn a living in the occupation of your choice, free from arbitrary or unreasonable government interference. I'll tell you about a couple of cases that are near and dear to my heart, one because I litigated it, and the other one because we won it. The first one is a law from Louisiana, which happens to be the only state in the country where you have to have a license from the government to be a florist. I'll say this again. You have to have a license from the state of Louisiana to take two flowers, put them together in an aesthetically pleasing way, and sell that to somebody. Now, only an infant could be unaware of the origins of this law and the purpose that it serves. But applying rational basis review, a court upheld the law, in part on the premise that the state of Louisiana might have been protecting its citizens from the hazards of infected dirt. Don't take my word for it, look it up in FSUP. The case is called Meadows v. Odom. Fortunately, it was vacated later on appeal because of Hurricane Katrina, but it's there. So, just by point of reference, by the way, the state of Louisiana was very serious about enforcing this law. In fact, they actually had floral police that would go out in force, particularly on Valentine's Day, and accost any store or merchant who presumed to sell floral arrangements, or even just a, you know what the funny thing was? You could actually sell a dozen roses, because that wasn't considered to be an arrangement, but if you put baby's breath in with them, then the floral police would show up and make you disaggregate the arrangement, so you only sold the roses in one bunch and the baby's breath in it. I'm not kidding. I litigated this case for 3 years, and that's how they interpreted the law. It's nuts. Well, it's nuts if you think that governments reliably seek to advance public-spirited justifications for the laws. It is not remotely nuts if you understand anything about public choice theory and the basis for much economic regulation, and then the regulation makes perfect sense. As did my other favorite statistic from the case, to get a license to practice floristry in Louisiana, you actually had to take a 4-hour practical exam in which you made 4 floral arrangements that were then graded, not by some theoretically disinterested bureaucrats, but by actually a panel of working florists who'd been brought in to judge the quality of your work and decide whether you were good enough to go into business and compete against them. Perhaps not surprisingly, the pass rate on the Louisiana florist exam was 33%. For point of reference, the pass rate on the Louisiana bar exam was 65%. About twice as hard to be a florist in Louisiana as it was to be a lawyer. Again, upholding a law like that is not judging. It's not judicial restraint. It's not humility. It's not laudable. It's selling out. It's make-believe judging. It's abdication. And that story sounds funny because it involves flowers, and that's humorous because who does the government think it is? There's a sad side of the story, too. The lead plaintiff in that case was a woman named Sandy Meadows. Sandy was a high school dropout from Mississippi. She was a widow, and she had no marketable skills at all, except that she could make floral arrangements. She was fired from her job at an Albertsons grocery store because they could not afford to employ both her and a licensed florist. Sandy had been unable to pass the highly subjective licensing exam. The last time I saw Sandy, she was recovering from gallbladder surgery in her, well, not in her apartment, she was outside of her apartment, in about 100 degree weather in Baton Rouge, 98% humidity. The reason she was outside the apartment is because she didn't have enough money to pay for electricity and had no air conditioning. I put her in a rental car, took her to the grocery store, wrote out a check to get her electricity turned on, and I checked her into a La Quinta Motor Inn so she could have at least one night in comfort. Sandy died alone and in poverty 2 weeks later with no job because the state of Louisiana said she had to have a license to be a florist, and the federal courts did nothing to protect her right to earn a living. That, to me, is the face of judicial restraint masquerading as abdication. I'm sorry, abdication masquerading as restraint. The other case I wanted to tell you about, the happier case, because so far we have won it. My colleague Jeff Rose, back in the back there, is helping to litigate this case. It is the third installment of an area that IJ has been litigating involving the constitutionality of state laws that require a funeral director's license to sell caskets. In Louisiana, in Oklahoma, and formerly Tennessee until IJ President Chip Miller succeeded in getting that law struck down, you actually have to have a license from the government, not just any license, but a funeral director's license to sell caskets. Casket, for those of you who don't know, is a large wooden or metal box. And these states require you to go to college and mortuary school and embalm bodies and all the rest just to sell this box. Why? Well, I think it's probably not irrelevant that funeral directors, and we proved this in three separate trials, funeral directors mark up the price of caskets anywhere from 300 to 600%. They will shamelessly take a casket that they get for $1,000 at wholesale and charge some grieving family $3,000 or $4,000 for that casket, and they do this day in and day out. As you can see, a very valuable monopoly to have. In that case, the state of Louisiana, again, seems to keep popping up in Louisiana, really had to search mightily for a conceivable justification. And of course, we know that under rational basis review, the justification neither had to be sincere nor factually supportable. It just had to be something that a lawyer could say in court with a reasonably straight face. And this is what they came up with. This is the best the state of Louisiana could do during a one-day bench trial that we had last summer. It seems that Louisianans are somewhat more corpulent than people in other states. And in order to know that someone who is a bit heavier than other people needs a larger casket, you have to go to funeral directing school to learn this valuable lesson. That is an argument. In fact, it was the argument that was asserted by the government in this case. Does it really cause us to have greater respect for a judiciary that accepts that argument at face value when the people benefiting from that law are systematically using it to rip off consumers and charge them 300 to 600% markup on caskets? I think not. I certainly don't think better of a judiciary that accepts that kind of falsehood at face value. Let me end by describing a case that involved, I think, a praiseworthy example of judicial engagement. As Steve mentioned, I was one of the lawyers in the Heller case. I don't really do gun litigation. I sort of like George in that Seinfeld episode. I won one gun rights case, and then I'm done. I'm out. But I've been watching it with some interest. And as many of you know, the follow-on case litigated by my co-counsel, Alan Gura, was McDonald versus City of Chicago, in which the Supreme Court incorporated, a word I don't use and don't like, but applied the right to keep and bear arms against the state of Illinois. Or I'm sorry, the City of Chicago, and struck down a handgun ban similar to the one in DC. Chicago then amended its law and tried to essentially walk it right up to the line of what it thought the Supreme Court would tolerate. And it did an interestingly, I would say, disingenuous thing, and that is it said, okay, you can have a license to have a gun now, but you have to have some time on a firing range in order to get that license. And then it banned all firing ranges in the city of Chicago. Isn't that cute? Like making you read up for your citizenship test and then banning all libraries or something like that. I mean, you know, if you happen to think that one right is as good as another, and that Second Amendment rights aren't second class just because they haven't been recognized for a couple of hundred years. The city of Chicago offered two justifications in support of this law. The first was, and I'm quoting from the opinion because you can't make this stuff up. This is the Seventh Circuit opinion written by Judge Diane Sykes, striking it down last July. The first concern that the city of Chicago identified was the risk of contamination from lead residue left on the range user's hands after firing a gun. Isn't it laudable that the city of Chicago is, of all the things that they have to worry about, and there are some issues in Chicago, as those of you who follow homicide rates may have noticed, it's lead residue on people's hands that's really concerning them. And the other one is my personal favorite. It's the risk of theft when would-be gun robbers gather around firing ranges to steal guns from people who are firing. I'm a Texan, by the way. I've grown up shooting, and I've been around some firing ranges. There are two kinds of people who go to firing ranges. Military and law enforcement, and people who have spent their whole lives fantasizing that someday somebody will try to steal their gun when they are at a firing range. This is an absolutely absurd justification. Under rational basis review, of course, it would have been accepted at face value because the government never needs to offer any evidence in a rational basis case. Judge Diane Sykes was having none of it, and she pointed out that in any other fundamental rights case, the city of Chicago would have had to offer actual, reliable evidence. That has an interesting ring to it, actual reliable evidence. What if the government had to do that in all constitutional cases? That would be a sea change. But they don't, and it leads to this kind of judicial abdication. And again, I'm going to quote from the Tenth Circuit in a case I litigated called Powers. It was the casket case from Oklahoma. In upholding that law, the Tenth Circuit took at face value our assertion that it was nothing but economic protectionism, and they said this: while baseball may be the national pastime of the citizenry, dishing out special economic benefits to certain in-state industries remains the favored pastime of state and local governments. It sure does. And that's why we have a constitution. What we need is an engaged judiciary to enforce it. Thank you.
I too want to thank the organizers for inviting me. I am one of a handful of outsiders on the program, and I'll be offering some comments that I hope will be provocative, but I don't know what the right word is. They're not intended. They're intended to be provocative, but they're not intended to be, I don't know, distancing myself from it or whatever. I actually, in preparing for this, without trying to analogize myself to the subject of this story, I was reminded of the time when then-Dean Elena Kagan welcomed the Federalist Society National Convention at Harvard, and her opening line was, "I love the Federalist Society," and then wild applause, and then she said, "But you are not my people." And that's sort of how I feel about this kind of enterprise. I really do like this sort of stuff. But you're not my people. I'm going to make a comment that is, I know, organizationally inaccurate and under the circumstances perhaps politically delicate, but it captures the idea behind my "I love this," the group. When I was living in Washington, I would occasionally go to Cato Institute associated sort of legal events, and I wouldn't go to Heritage or AEI events, at least after Bob Goodwin left. And the reason was that at the Heritage events, I knew pretty much what I was going to get were Republican talking points, and I didn't need that. Whereas if I went to Cato, it would actually be interesting. And that's sort of how I feel about this kind of, the IJ sort of stuff. Okay, one final point. I arrived late today because of a medical comedy of errors at our house. And so some of the things I say may repeat things that were said before I arrived. Now, the substance of my comments are this. It's sort of how we got from judicial activism and restraint to judicial engagement. It seems to me there's a structural similarity between the problems faced by progressives after, in the late 1930s, after the Roosevelt Court Roosevelt transformed the Supreme Court, and conservatives today. The structural similarity is that in the prior era, progressives and conservatives, in the era prior to the times I've identified, progressives and conservatives had developed an account of what was going wrong on the courts. And both accounts were that the courts were being overly activist, that they were invalidating things without adequate justification. And as a result of that account, both progressives before the 1937 transformation and conservatives before, I don't know, let's say 1986, said that the remedy should be something that they called judicial restraint. Courts shouldn't be doing this sort of thing. Then, again, the structural similarity is in 1937 through 41, the progressives took over the Supreme Court, and in some period in the 1980s, conservatives took over the Supreme Court too. And then people had to decide, now that you're in control, what do you do? And there are two options. One is to just follow your old theory and say, you know, we're now in charge, they were doing the wrong thing, we'll do the right thing, we won't invalidate legislation. The other thing you can do is figure out some way to keep on invalidating legislation of the kind that you don't like. And the progressives after 1937 actually divided on this, but predominantly they took the second path. One reason for doing, for making the choice is, or that affects the choice, is whether you think that your allies, you the judges, I'm describing, think that your allies are going to control the legislatures, or whether you think that they're not going to. If you think that they're going to control the legislatures, then the theory of judicial restraint is fine, because legislatures aren't going to be doing anything that you don't like. But if you aren't confident about that, or if you think that there's a lot of sort of mopping up work that needs to be done, legislation enacted before your folks took over the legislatures, then you're going to want to, or at least you will think it might be sensible to, figure out some way of justifying acting against those legislatures that you don't control. Okay, so the structural problem is similar, and the resolution, I think, is similar as well. What happened was, in both instances, theorists and then judges said, well, you know, we were talking about judicial restraint, but that wasn't exactly what we meant. What we meant was that the courts were invalidating legislation without the right reasons for doing so. So now we're going to invalidate legislation, but for the right reasons. So for the, again, for the Warren Court, it was, I don't know, you can call it living constitutionalism or footnote 4 or whatever. It didn't really matter. They had a story about what were the right bases for invalidating legislation. For conservatives, the first candidate was originalism. That is, courts should invalidate legislation that's inconsistent with some version of original some version of an originalist theory. Originalist theory evolved over time, and I don't really want to worry for now about the details of it, because this may set off some hackles. My own view, I think I could defend this in a more extended way, is that I actually can put it I can almost date it. Last year, originalism jumped the shark. For those of you who don't know what jumping the shark is, it means it's used to be interesting. Now it's just, you know, playing boring. And the reason I say last year is that last year you had these two events. Jack Balkin published a book called Living Originalism, in which he said, I will provide an originalist defense for everything that I think is a good idea, and for upholding everything I think is a good idea and striking down everything I don't think is a good idea. And Steve Calabresi published an article providing an originalist defense of strict scrutiny in cases involving gender discrimination. And I just actually literally 10 minutes ago got an email noting that he's coming out with an article providing an originalist defense of Loving against Virginia and the anti-miscegenation and the argument that anti-miscegenation laws are unconstitutional. If that's what originalism means, if Balkin and Calabresi are both originalists, it's back where we were before originalism was on the table. You have these ways of explaining how anything you want, anything you think is unconstitutional in originalist terms. I would note, people say, oh, Jack Balkin, he's not, this isn't real originalism. He's got no credentials. I don't think you can say that about Steve Calabresi. I mean, Calabresi's answered by Ed Whalen. It becomes an intramural dispute among originalists, which I certainly can't adjudicate, because I am not an originalist. But as an observer of the discourse, I just observe that it is now essentially uniformly available. I actually think that's okay from the point of view of the Institute of Justice and Judicial Engagement, because my own sense is that the Judicial Engagement project, as I would put it, gestures in the direction of originalism, but its program isn't interestingly originalist. I did hear some of David Bernstein's comments this morning, and I think I took him to be suggesting that, which seems to me right. It's originalist only in the sense that everybody says we ought to pay some attention to original understanding, or it's originalist in the sense that you describe the original understanding on a quite high level of abstraction without worrying about what the original understanding about particular constitutional provisions was, or without it being the only way to think about these things. So if originalism has jumped the shark, what could you do? And I think that the program, again, from an outsider's point of view, the program of judicial engagement is a substitute solution for the problem of what do you do after you've taken control of the courts, but aren't sure of your reliable control of legislatures. My description of the project of judicial engagement is something like this. And again, David Bernstein will, this may resonate with some things that David Bernstein said. With respect to taking Lochner as our central case, the project of judicial engagement sides with Peckham against Holmes in Lochner. Holmes says the Constitution doesn't have any theory, economic theory underlying it. There's no substantive theory grounding the Constitution. Peckham says, yes, there is. And he's got an account of what that theory is. But the project of judicial engagement sides with Harlan against Peckham about what do you do with that theory. That is, Harlan says, okay, you've got this theory about freedom of contract and so on. Let's look at the facts of the case to see whether there's a decent justification for what the government's doing. Now, I don't want to say that Institute for Justice people would agree with Harlan's analysis of the factual issues in Lochner. I just would say that the project is a Harlan-like project. There is a substantive economic theory, and the way the courts are supposed to do things is to look at the extent to which, look at whether the facts in the case and problem at hand map onto that theory in a way that explains or justifies the judicial intervention. Another sort of more general characterization is that the project of judicial engagement is, I have this in my notes, as a moderate libertarianism, and I think Clark's presentation suggested the moderate nature of it. Doug Kmeck's comments in the prior session suggest that maybe a better description would be that it is provisionally or incrementally moderately libertarian. That is, Doug's suggestion was that if you IJ folks were in the conference room with the four conservative justices, they would say you have to have, in his terms, have built the infrastructure before you take this big step. We're not in principle opposed to the big step libertarianism. It's just that for a variety of reasons, you shouldn't do that right away without the infrastructure having been built. Okay, the final two points I want to make are these. The structure of moderate or provisionally moderate libertarianism is a familiar structure within the general discourse of constitutional theory. There's a substantive theory of, call it justice, that the Constitution embodies, which the courts should enforce. In other domains, that's Ronald Dworkin's theory. Structurally, it is just a Dworkinian theory. It's disagreement about what the theory of justice is, but the structural idea is Dworkinian. And so I want to conclude with this suggestion about, so why come up with a new term? Why engagement rather than activism? Why engagement rather than Dworkinian libertarianism? The latter, because doesn't sell quite as well, but it doesn't sound as nice, but actually the sell quite as well is my final suggestion, which is what's going on here is a sort of product differentiation. So Dworkinianism has been tarnished by its association with liberalism. You can't call what your project is right-wing Dworkinianism, because the people you're trying to raise money from aren't going to either appreciate what that means or aren't going to like it being called Dworkinian. And I think my own view, this is a little less certain about this, but the idea of engagement is a way of differentiating the IJ project from other conservative legal, I will call them activist projects. If again, to put it in fundraising terms, if the project here were called conservative legal activism, then people would ask, well, why should I support you, go to your events, give you money, instead of giving money or going to the events of other conservative legal activists? And the answer is, well, because we're not the same as they are. We have a distinctive program, which is this notion of engagement. Now, I don't think there's anything wrong with product differentiation of this sort. Indeed, I think it's sort of, at some level, an organizational imperative for the development of maybe vibrant movements. And so the fact that there is this notion of judicial engagement, which is not yet fully developed, but which can be developed through litigation and so on, that seems to me, and that it's distinct from generalized conservative activism, seems to me an interesting and provocative development.
I want to thank everybody responsible for organizing the symposium and also everybody that came as well. I've always had a very simple-minded view of judicial duty in constitutional cases. Supreme Court justices should just apply the law. For that reason, I reject the standard version of living constitutionalism, according to which the court should take every feasible opportunity to make the Constitution conform with a progressive vision of an evolving society and a morally evolving society. I should probably mention, I thought that one became lost interest in that one about 75 years ago. stop being interesting about then. And I reject a view sometimes found among libertarians, according to which the court should always be looking for a way to make the Constitution fit with a political theory that's often attributed, rightly or wrongly, to John Locke. Nor do I accept the view that economic efficiency is the proper criterion for the validity of judicial decisions. Some conservatives also seem to me to go astray when they promote Burkean traditionalism. And I certainly don't think that the justices should simply defer whenever possible to legislatures or act so as to protect the political interests of the courts. If I had to put a label on my own position, it would be originalism. The Constitution is a written document that means what its words and context would reasonably have been understood to mean at the time it was adopted. Originalism faces two major challenges. First, it's frequently difficult and sometimes impossible to identify the original meaning of a legal text with anything approaching the specificity required for deciding cases. It's easy enough to say that the justices should just apply the law, but that presupposes that they can find out what the law is. If that were the only problem, the simple answer would be that they should just try as best they can to honestly weigh all the relevant arguments and evidence about the original meaning of the text. Of course, they're bound to make mistakes. They're human, as were those who wrote the Constitution. But it would be silly to reject an interpretive theory just because it will sometimes fall short of its proper aspirations. The second challenge is related to the first, but it's considerably more difficult. The doctrine and practice of stare decisis creates a real tension with the principle of originalism, precisely because the Supreme Court undoubtedly has made and will inevitably continue to make serious interpretive mistakes. What should justices do when they encounter a conflict between the original meaning of the Constitution and the precedents that are already on the books? Some commentators have sliced through this Gordian knot by repudiating the doctrine of stare decisis. This terrible swift sword has the virtue of producing a clean cut, leaving devotion to the Constitution to stand in all its splendid purity. If the results upset some apple carts, say by declaring paper money unconstitutional, well, that's why we have Article 5. I think this elegant solution is wrong. The original meaning of the Constitution incorporated the principle of stare decisis. The application of that principle, in various different versions to be sure, had for a very long time been a central function of all the Anglo-American courts with which the founding generation was familiar. When Article 3 granted federal courts the judicial power of the United States, I think it must have been presumed that this includes the power and perhaps the obligation to apply the principle of stare decisis. Now, the text obviously doesn't compel this conclusion, but there's an abundance of historical evidence that supports it, and I haven't seen any evidence that could refute it. Originalists, myself included, have pretty much been condemned to muddle along without any usefully precise theory to explain how judges should respond to conflicts between the original meaning of the Constitution and erroneous or extremely dubious precedents. Probably the most common substitute for such a theory has been to accept stare decisis as an unavoidable pragmatic exception to the fundamental principle of applying the Constitution according to its original meaning. Not surprisingly, that has exposed originalists to considerable scorn and ridicule, especially from proponents of the leftist versions of living constitutionalism. Justice Scalia has been a favorite target of these attacks, and he's frequently accused of applying originalist analysis when it gets the results he likes, and of deferring to precedent when that suits his policy agenda. I've always been bothered by a sense that Scalia's critics on the left have a point, and that I or any other originalist might well be exposed to the same charges if faced with the obligation to decide a great many difficult cases. This is a serious problem, and I wish I could report that I finally come up with a solution while I was getting ready for this symposium. No such luck. For that reason, I'm going to have to echo Eric Claes's comment this morning that my talk will be modest and it will have much to be modest about. But I hope to throw a little light on the problem by considering a novel and provocative solution suggested by my colleague, Jonathan Mitchell. Using only the constitutional text and rejecting extra-textual pragmatic considerations, he claims to identify those cases in which the Supreme Court may and may not permissibly adhere to judicial precedents that are inconsistent with the original meaning of the Constitution. Mitchell's argument is based on the language of the Supremacy Clause. That clause identifies three kinds of law that are supreme: the Constitution, federal statutes, and treaties. By implication, all other kinds of law, including judicial opinions, are non-supreme and must always give way to the supreme law of the land. Mitchell also notes that the Supremacy Clause does not rank the three kinds of supreme law among themselves. So far as the text indicates, they're all supreme, and none of them is more supreme than the others. Similarly, the constitutional text does not provide any ranking among the various forms of non-supreme law, such as Supreme Court opinions and state laws. From these features of the text, Mitchell argues that it is unconstitutional for the Supreme Court to rely on stare decisis when, but only when, its precedents, which are a form of non-supreme law, conflict with one of the three kinds of supreme law. Conversely, the Constitution does not forbid the court to follow its precedents, even when they're wrong, when they conflict with a non-supreme law, or when two forms of supreme law conflict with each other. Now, this argument has some unorthodox implications, which we can see with four examples, some of which are Mitchell's and some of which are my own. First, the court always violates the Constitution when it strikes down a federal statute on the basis of an erroneous precedent. Doing so effectively elevates a non-supreme law, namely the applicable precedent, over a supreme law, namely the federal statute. For example, Bowling versus Sharp mistakenly invested the Fifth Amendment with an equal protection component in order to invalidate racial segregation in the DC public schools. Mitchell's theory, therefore, would forbid the court to rely on Bowling to invalidate federal affirmative action programs. Second, the court always violates the Constitution when it relies on stare decisis to uphold a state law that conflicts with the Constitution. Doing so effectively elevates a non-supreme law, namely the state statute, over a supreme law, namely the Constitution. Wickard versus Filburn, for example, mistakenly authorized Congress to regulate an intrastate activity by aggregating the effects of many such activities on interstate commerce. Mitchell's theory permits the court to rely on this erroneous precedent, as it did when it upheld the federal prohibition on possessing homegrown medical marijuana in Gonzalez versus Raich. Third, the court does not violate the Constitution when it upholds a federal statute on the basis of an erroneous precedent. When the court is faced with a conflict between the Constitution and a federal statute, both of which are supreme laws, it has to apply a tie-breaking rule, and the Constitution provides no such rule. It is therefore constitutionally permissible for the court to use stare decisis as a tiebreaker. The Contracts Clause, for example, was misinterpreted in Home Building and Loan Association versus Blaisdell, which upheld a state law prohibiting the enforcement of existing contractual terms. Mitchell's theory forbids the court to rely on Blaisdell in future cases. Fourth, the court does not violate the Constitution when it strikes down a state law on the basis of an erroneous precedent. Here again, a tie-breaking rule is required, because the Constitution does not say that one kind of non-supreme law must necessarily override another. The Constitution is not violated when the court uses stare decisis to break the tie. Thus, for example, Roe versus Wade was wrongly decided, but the Constitution does not forbid the court from continuing to invalidate state laws on its authority. Now, I think the most important question to ask about Mitchell's theory is whether it's consistent with the original meaning of the Constitution. But before getting to that, I have to point out that Mitchell's argument, even assuming that it's correct, leaves originalism's difficulties largely unresolved. First, his theory offers no way to identify those precedents that are so clearly erroneous that they must be treated as deviations from the original meaning. I think the examples of erroneous precedents that I just offered should be accepted by almost any informed and candid originalist, and Mitchell offers some additional suggestions, but I'm not sure I could extend the list very far. Is it really possible in most cases to decide, without being influenced by what one thinks the Constitution should mean, how clearly erroneous a precedent must be in order to justify rejecting it? In some cases, I think it is, but such cases may be relatively scarce. Another unresolved difficulty is how to decide when stare decisis should be used as a tiebreaker. According to Mitchell's argument, the Constitution permits the Supreme Court to follow a clearly erroneous precedent in upholding a federal statute or in striking down a state statute. But permission is not a command. Accordingly, even if you're persuaded that a great many precedents are erroneous, they will include many in which the Supremacy Clause does not dictate whether they should be followed or not. In those cases, should one be guided by how confident one is that the precedents are erroneous, or by other factors, such as promoting legal stability and protecting settled expectations? Or should one somehow weigh the strength of one's convictions about the original meaning along with such pragmatic factors? Can one take either of these approaches without being influenced, perhaps quite significantly, by what one thinks the Constitution should mean? I have my doubts. That brings me to the main question: how persuasive is Mitchell's arguments on its own terms? And the reason it's the main question is because if Mitchell is right, we finally have an original meaning, textual argument that eliminates the tension between originalism and stare decisis. So it's a significant point. One of his key textual arguments is that the Supremacy Clause draws a sharp distinction between the three forms of supreme law and all other kinds of law. Mitchell, however, draws this conclusion entirely from a fragment of the clause without considering the entire text. The first part, which is what Mitchell relies on, reads as follows: the Constitution and the laws of the United States, which shall be made in pursuance thereof, and all treaties made or which shall be made under the authority of the United States shall be the supreme law of the land. But that's not the end of the sentence. It goes on: and the judges in every state shall be bound thereby, anything in the Constitution or laws of any state to the contrary notwithstanding. Read as a whole, the Supremacy Clause offers a clear statement that state judges are required to follow supreme federal law even when it conflicts with state law. It made a lot of sense to include such a clear statement in the Constitution. When the Constitution was adopted, state law was deprived at a stroke of its previous status as supreme law. Thus, state judges were suddenly required to reorient their approach to adjudication, and there was good reason to remove any ambiguity or doubt about this dramatic new legal constraint. The principle and practice of stare decisis, however, was at least as well established as the previous status of state laws within their several jurisdictions. Yet no such clear statement about a new limitation on stare decisis appears in the Supremacy Clause. The natural reading of the clause is that it is simply silent about stare decisis. Its manifest purpose is to clarify the dramatic new relation between state and federal law, and especially to make that relation unmistakably clear to state judges. Mitchell's claim that the mere use of the word supreme in the course of this clarification also implies that the Supreme Court must adopt a novel and complex doctrine of stare decisis is imaginative, but I don't think it's very plausible. In addition, the sharp distinction that Mitchell draws between supreme law and non-supreme law would also seem to imply that erroneous interpretations of federal statutes may never be adhered to. This would constitute an extremely radical change from the judicial practice with which the framing generation was familiar. and it's hard to believe that such an alteration would have been adopted by mere implication from the use of the word supreme in the Supremacy Clause. Now, apart from these textual objections to Mitchell's textual argument, is he right that the Supremacy Clause implies that the Supreme Court is always permitted by the Constitution to rely on erroneous precedents to uphold a federal statute or to strike down a state statute? I think not. The fact, for example, that the Supremacy Clause does not expressly privilege the Constitution over federal statutes does not necessarily imply that the Constitution might not implicitly do so. Arguments for ranking the Constitution above federal statutes are well known, having been given prominent expression in Federalist No. 78, Marbury versus Madison. The fact that the Supremacy Clause does not expressly confirm the validity of these arguments does not constitute a refutation of them. Similarly, the fact that the Supremacy Clause does not expressly privilege constitutionally valid state laws over erroneous Supreme Court opinions does not necessarily imply that the Constitution might not implicitly do so. So in the end, I'm left in the unhappy predicament with which I began. Originalism has an irreducibly uneasy relationship with stare decisis. The two seem to be wedded in a way that precludes divorce and thus encourages adultery. I think that Jonathan Mitchell's effort to play an old-fashioned domestic relations lawyer and reconcile the two is a failure, but his argument does throw some useful light on what I think is originalism's greatest challenge. His argument also suggests what I think may be a more fruitful line of inquiry or of argument. Mitchell is certainly right that the Constitution identifies three forms of supreme law, and the Supreme Court opinions are not included in that list. If I'm right that the clause is directed primarily at state courts, I think we have to wonder whether those courts are required to follow Supreme Court opinions that conflict with the federal Constitution or federal statutes. On its face, the Supremacy Clause seems to command state courts to ignore erroneous Supreme Court opinions. Even if one thinks that Supreme Court judgments must be respected, perhaps its opinions should be treated as non-binding by state courts. That would actually make some sense of the entire text of the Supremacy Clause, and it might help to induce the Supreme Court to make an effort to write better opinions, by which I mean more persuasive opinions, than it sometimes does. Perhaps the court would even become a little less reluctant to correct its own mistakes. Thank you very much.
Well, thank you very much for those terrific remarks. I'm going to exercise the moderator's prerogative and ask the first question. What I want to do is pick up on what I see to be the central question or challenge that Professor Tushnet posed to those who are in favor of judicial engagement. Maybe to paraphrase Gertrude Stein with respect to judicial engagement, is there any there? What is this really all about? Are we just, is this just deja vu all over again? Are we just taking up the mantle of those who operated under the banner of judicial activism when that was not a pejorative and effectively trying to do the same thing through different means? On the last panel, Professor Levinson made what I think is a very good point. He said that a good argument can be made for the idea that all nine justices on the Supreme Court are activists, which I think is a very good insight. And I would add to that that if it's true, I think one could make exactly the same argument that all nine justices on the Supreme Court are also practitioners of restraint. Namely that, to put the point more particularly, judicial activism versus judicial restraint often seems to be simply an ad hoc epithet on the one hand or a positive statement about a case depending on whether you like it or you dislike it. Is that all that judicial engagement is about? So I want to start with Clark to take that question first, and then perhaps we can get thoughts on that from Professor Lund, and then maybe circle back to Professor Tushnet to address those comments, if that's okay. Go ahead, Clark.
Yeah, I don't think that's a close call at all. Of course there's a difference between an engaged and an unengaged judge. If you have judges who in some classes of cases will ask the government, what are you really doing, and refuse to accept explanations for which there is no evidence or which is, you know, not plausible. And by the way, courts do this all the time. They do this in First Amendment free expression cases, free exercise. They do it in cases of alleged invidious discrimination. Courts will absolutely reject an implausible, insincere, or unsupported explanation for government conduct, and they will evaluate the challenge distinction or law according to its actual objectives. And courts are explicit about not doing that in certain classes of cases. It's not that they say, well, you know, we really can't figure out what's going on here in the Caskets case. Instead, they say, we're not even going to try to figure out what's really going on here in the Caskets case. And I think that is a very real, very discernible difference. It has absolutely no business in our jurisprudence, in any jurisprudence of constitutional law, as far as I'm concerned, because it's make-believe judging, it's fake, it's insincere, it's disingenuous, and it needs to go. And if that's all we accomplish with judicial engagement, it will be a sea change, modest but important sea change in American constitutional law. And the fact that I've debated this issue about 25 times this year and I've never heard anybody yet try to defend the core of what I think is wrong with modern judging, which is this dichotomy where they take some cases seriously and takes other cases utterly unseriously, I think is quite encouraging and suggests that maybe the project can succeed.
Well, I certainly agree that the court should take all of the Constitution seriously, and judicial activism, which is a bad thing, is when they don't interpret the Constitution correctly and don't do their job right, and judicial engagement is when they do it right, and sometimes that results in upholding statutes and sometimes it doesn't, but of course that leaves all the hard questions unanswered, and as I indicated, I keep trying to come up with a good answer to give us an algorithm for figuring out when the Constitution has been interpreted correctly, and I can't do it.
I guess I have two observations. One is just to note that it's not my position that there's no there with respect to the idea of judicial engagement. I'm trying to figure out how it differs from, in particular, well, how it emerged out of a certain historical context and how it differs from other things that emerged out of that context. The other is that it's not, I have to think about getting this formulation exactly right, and I may not get it precisely, but I don't think anybody contends that the judicial enterprise, call it judging, differs depending on the subject matter that's presented to the court. The disagreements are over what is good performance of that activity of judging in light of the nature of the problem presented to the courts. That last part is not exactly right, but I'm working on the fly here. And there are people who will say that the exercise of good judgment with respect to problem A will play itself out, as you write the opinion, in a way that is different from the way it plays itself out in other settings. Now, I'm not sure that's right, frankly, but it seems to me when judges say, here's an example that I've worried about recently because it actually turns out to be quite hard. Well, obviously, it's unconstitutional under the First Amendment to ban a display of a Jackson Calder stabile in public because they're ugly. That's clearly unconstitutional. But it's not unconstitutional to ban ticket scalping. It turns out it's actually hard to explain why you reach one judgment rather than the other. But when they try to explain it, they're talking in the same kind of way, it seems to me. And so they're both engaged in judging. At some point, I can't retrieve this from memory, but in some opinion, there's this exchange between Justices Breyer and Scalia, in which Justice Breyer says, well, look, I'm looking at all this stuff and evidence and so on, and when I take everything into account, I'm exercising judgment, and I come out saying that this thing is constitutionally permissible. And Justice Scalia says, wait a minute, looking at all that stuff, that's not judging. That judging is having these rules that say yes or no. My inclination is to say, if you're trying to describe judging, what Justice Breyer was describing is like the project of judicial engagement. It was a case in which he came out on the other side from the way the IJ would, but I think. But it's, okay, anyway. It's just not clear to me that the description of judging versus not judging maps onto the behavior with which this project is concerned.
Okay, why don't we turn to questions from the audience. Professor Levinson, you can kick it off.
Art, it seems to me that your presentation is certainly in tension, maybe in fatal tension, with some of the arguments made in the previous panel, because there we heard a great deal about the wonders of federalism, and Doug gave a very moving allusion to neighborhoods and local governance. But as I mentioned in my own remarks, in the 10th Federalist, Madison said it's just the neighborhood, it's just the locality that is most likely to be captured by factions. And you corroborate this, that you're not talking, except for your comment about Heller, you're not talking about the overreaching national government. And even with Heller, it's the peculiarity that District of Columbia is treated at least sometime as the national government rather than a state. But it's not, you're not talking about traditional national legislation. So what you're really talking about is the ability of well-located factions, especially in a state like Louisiana. I mean, frankly, it's not surprising that a number of your examples would arise in Louisiana. You go back to the slaughterhouse. And so that's why you need a strong national government, and we can talk in some cases about a strong judiciary. Justice Holmes said, I don't really care if we can review national legislation, but it's really important that we monitor state legislation. Or you could have Congress empowered to pass a law simply getting rid of florists. Regulation. I mean, just as is true of Randy's presentation on Williamson, you make a very compelling argument for striking down the casket law and the florist law, but they're state laws. They're our federalism. So I really do wonder where you stand on our federalism.
Well, I appreciate the question. I'm fortunate enough to have something that the Supreme Court lacks, which is a theory of the Privileges or Immunities Clause of the 14th Amendment. The Supreme Court had an opportunity to develop a theory, as you know, in 1873 and declined to do so, and has declined to do so every time it's been presented to it, including most recently in the McDonald gun case. And so essentially the Supreme Court is sort of flying the 14th Amendment around the country blind, and it's no accident that sometimes it gets it right and sometimes it doesn't. I happen to believe that we fought a civil war in part over civil rights, mostly over the principle that you can't own another human being, but of course the South tried to act as if the war hadn't been won by the North, and so they denied not just newly freed blacks, but all people of basic civil rights. And I think the 14th Amendment was rather obviously passed to empower the federal government, particularly the federal courts, to enforce civil rights at the state and local level. It's an interesting point about Congress, I suppose. They might have a power under Section 5 to pass legislation to get rid of something pernicious like the Louisiana Florist Law, I won't be holding my breath.
Next question. David.
So I hold three different views that are typically held by people of different constitutional ideologies, and I hold them simultaneously, one of which is that the text of the Constitution deserves to be taken seriously because it is the supreme law of the land. The second is that the constitutional interpretation is and was meant to be, to some extent, not just political, but also to have the people have some say over the Constitution. The constitutional debate is not supposed to be limited to the judiciary and lawyers, but there is some popular constitutionalism involved. And the third thing that I believe is that that one of the progressive critiques of Supreme Court jurisprudence in the 20th century, or early 20th century, that has stayed with us, which is that the judiciary isn't especially competent to decide a lot of these issues involving complex legislation, and whether it's really arbitrary or not, is actually a very valid critique, that judges get just legal briefs in front of them. They can't, they don't have experts, and they can't find out exactly how strongly people feel about things and why. So my resolution, I mean, it's not a very clear-cut resolution, but my overall resolution to this is that there should be some sort of constitutional engagement. It doesn't necessarily, with the judiciary serving as a backdrop, it doesn't necessarily have to be judicial engagement. The judiciary should defer when there has been engagement by the elected branches, who are then in turn responsible to the people. And the problem we have with a lot of legislation nowadays is that the elected officials don't take the Constitution seriously. It ranges from the infamous example of former Speaker Pelosi being asked about the constitutional justification for the individual mandate and responding, are you serious? Are you serious? Like, of course we could do whatever we want to do. There's a whole series of, I once collected these on the Vala conspiracy, whole series of other congressmen who were asked about the constitutional justification. They refer to various constitutional provisions that don't exist. They said we could do whatever we want, and so forth and so on. And of course, there are all sorts of examples we can come up with when there's debate over some provision, is it constitutional or not, of any kind of law, and people say, oh, who cares about that? We'll pass it, let the courts worry about it. And I think even in the cases that Clark was talking about, if you actually had some constitutional debate, look, right to earn a living, that seems like a liberty right, what is our justification for it? And a politician, as opposed to a lawyer writing briefs where they have to defend the law, would get up and say, well, we're worried about corpulent Louisianans not being able to fit into their caskets. People would laugh at them. There'd be editorials. The law would never pass. So where am I going with this? You might be wondering why I'm going with this. Is maybe part of what we should be thinking about here, or at least IJ should be thinking about here, is that the issue isn't simply judicial engagement, but constitutional engagement more broadly. And you should be just as happy and maybe happier if you could actually get state legislatures and congressmen and whatnot to be taking the Constitution seriously, and then you wouldn't need to rely so much on the courts.
As Hemingway said, it would be pretty to think so. Doesn't make it so. I grew up sort of on a farm, and when we left the door open to where the feed for the goats got in and ate it all. And there was no surprise. I think the courts have actually sort of helped to teach legislators not to take the Constitution very seriously. I'll give you an example. We just litigated a case in Florida that requires a 4-year college degree and a 2-year apprenticeship to be an interior designer, also not making that up. Amazingly, not in Louisiana, although they have a similar law. The state stipulated in that case that it had no evidence that the law protected any, advanced any public purpose or protected the public in any way. We also presented the court with about a dozen state studies from other states that looked at it very carefully and showed there was absolutely no danger from unlicensed interior design or that it presented a genuine public risk. The 11th Circuit blew right past all that, seized on a report in the legislative history that had been tendered by the lobbying group that got the law in the books, in which they made a completely unsubstantiated claim that it had something to do with safety, and the 11th Circuit turned around and said, oh, look, it's a safety regulation. So it's a kind of rationale or justification laundering. And by the way, those same interest groups, they are now citing the 11th Circuit's decision that interior design laws have something to do with safety. They literally managed to launder a fraudulent representation to the legislature that it had no support, was then picked up on by the courts in a rational basis setting, and turned into something with substance. I think the courts are basically unrealistic in thinking they can exempt themselves from that process completely, and that they don't have any kind of a
feedback loop that they create when they rubber stamp laws for which no real justification can be offered. And I'll say one more point, David, with respect to your point about legislative versus judicial competency. I think of it this way. Imagine you're driving around the inner city late at night looking for a place to park your car, and you see some guy slouching on the corner, and he looks like a thug in a hood, and he is, but he's got a gun. Well, that guy's very well equipped to guard your car if you choose to leave it with him. He's very well equipped to do that. Ask yourself whether you would, because he's got other incentives and other motives that you might want to think about before you leave your car with him. I feel the same way about liberty.
Just a small point about what Clark just said about the courts helping to teach legislatures not to pay any attention to the Constitution. There's probably something to that, but I think less than is often supposed, and my evidence is this. After the Kentucky and Virginia resolutions were enacted, which we talked about this morning, or on one of the previous panels, several states adopted their own resolution saying, but out, this is for the courts to decide. This isn't your business, and it's not our business. And of course, that was before Marbury versus Madison. I think there's something deeper that's preventing, and may have been just political rhetoric on the part of those state legislatures to some extent, but I think there is something deeper in our system that encourages legislatures to defer to courts on legal questions, including constitutional questions that maybe they shouldn't defer to them on. I think there's something deeper.
Other questions?
I wonder, why don't state judges enforce state constitutions to strike down these absurd laws?
They do sometimes. We actually have an economic liberty case up on appeal in Texas right now, where one of my colleagues in our Austin office argued a case involving state cosmetology board's attempt to run out of business these eyebrow threaders. You may have seen at the mall, they pluck eyebrows with string. And we had a very engaged panel, apparently. I wasn't there, but I heard of favorable reports, and so it can happen. Texas actually happens to be a state where they haven't decided yet whether to follow the sort of the hands-off, make-believe judging form of rational basis review or what's sometimes called the real and substantial relation form of rational basis review. Of course, we're urging them to do the latter, and remains to be seen. So there is something to that. There is perhaps work to be done there, but I think it's reasonable to say that any court that you're in front of should engage in real judging and not sham judging. And again, that really is the core of the project of the Center for Judicial Engagement, is to say, let's have real judging in all cases. You want to have tiered scrutiny, you want to have different levels of scrutiny, that's okay. But actually judge in all cases. Don't play for the government, don't make up facts, don't make up justifications. In my opinion, that's not judging of any kind.
I guess this is a genuine question, again, which I can't get formulated exactly right, but from the perspective of a person who likes the New Deal expansive national government, which at the moment I'm not going to say is me, but from the perspective of such a person, I guess if you offered such a person, such a person could say, we're going to put the Institute of Justice out of business by having them win all their cases. I think that person would say, fine, let's if that's what judicial engagement means, cosmetology. I'm big on anti-ticket scalping laws. That is, I think they are completely indefensible. But your whole program, you win, and then we chug along, with the Affordable Care Act. At some level, why shouldn't the broader society regard this program as actually quite marginal to what matters? because you have bigger game in view, presumably. But that's another
question. I'm not so sure about that. I mean, you know, Suzette would still have a nice view of Long Island Sound. Sandy Meadows might still be alive. And, you know, our clients who are threading eyebrows wouldn't have to mess around with a bunch of idiot bureaucrats from the state of Texas. That strikes me as not at all a small thing. So maybe we just evaluate the magnitude of what would happen if we got real judging in all cases differently. I think it would be a modest change in the sense that it would only require a slightly different form of adjudication, but I think it would affect a sea change on the way the landscape looks, because frankly, the government is often unable to present any evidence to support a lot of these laws because they weren't enacted for legitimately public-spirited purposes. And if the agreement we're going to have is let's get rid of all those laws and we both wave our hands and make that happen, I will happily retire from the Institute for Justice and go sit on a beach and have my eyebrows threaded.
I don't think you need that.
I actually want to pick up on that point and ask the question slightly differently and get reactions from the panelists. Which is, instead of why not just get rid of all of the laws that we at the Institute for Justice don't like, why not just get rid of the rational basis test? As on the theory, as Randy Barnett said this morning, that it doesn't amount to much of anything at all. I mean, it's not even minimally, it's not really a rational basis test. It's really just it's so much deference that it amounts to an automatic win for the government. It's effectively denying judicial review while pretending, as perhaps Clark would put it, and you can disagree with my formulation of it, and that's part of what I want to get to. But if we got rid of that and reverted back to, as Randy pointed out, and I think David Bernstein pointed out, really we wouldn't have to go very far back, just to Caroline Product. Would that be such a problem? Would that be a big deal? It would seems to me, and I think Randy also made this point, wouldn't be fundamentally different from what the Supreme Court and the courts often do in First Amendment cases, not even strict scrutiny cases. Commercial speech, intermediate scrutiny, doesn't seem like the sky has fallen in that area. Would that be objectionable? Let me start with Professor Tushnet, and then Professor Lund, you can comment. I think I know what Clark might say to that, so we can ask you two first.
Well, my instinct is to say everything's going to depend on what content is given to what will now be a new doctrinal formulation. So Nelson will know more about this than I do, but my sense of the developing lower court law on the Second Amendment is that the judges are saying these things require, these regulations have to be subjected to what they call intermediate scrutiny. And from my perspective, it doesn't look like there's much difference between that and what they would have done had they been told, you don't have to, this is low-level rational basis review. And that description might be wrong of what's going on, but it captures the problem, which is, so if the substitute is real and substantial basis, first of all, we don't have much experience with it, which means that the judges are going to have to flesh it out. And we don't really know how they'll flesh it out. It could be almost, a smidgen tighter than mere rationality. Or it could be a smidgen short of strict scrutiny, which is what I think happens in the commercial speech cases.
So let me address that last point first about the Second Amendment jurisprudence. I think that's not a bad description of what's roughly going on. They're purporting to kind of apply tiers of scrutiny analysis and always finding some way to say that almost always finding some way to say that the regulation survived, often applying intermediate scrutiny in a way that's indistinguishable from rational basis review because the government offers these ludicrous things and they say, okay, fine, that's conceivable. And it passes intermediate scrutiny. So that sometimes happens. The Zell case, which Clark mentioned earlier, is an exception where you have a judge actually doing an intelligent analysis and one that respects the Constitution more than most of the others. Then there's also an interesting debate that's occurred in the D.C. Circuit in a case where the majority did this kind of sloppy intermediate scrutiny kind of analysis. That's that's not quite precise, but it's roughly what went on. And then Judge Kavanaugh said, oh, you completely misread Heller. We don't do tiers of scrutiny anymore. We're now doing text, history, and tradition. So who knows where that debate will go. I don't have much doubt myself that Kavanaugh's idea is not going anywhere, but we'll see. But turning back to the original main question, suppose you got rid of rational basis scrutiny. If you were an originalist, which I understand that very few people are, then you would have to ask, well, which, if you want to call it heightened scrutiny or whatever substitute for rational basis there's going to be, which laws does it apply to? And at the moment, rational basis scrutiny applies to all laws. And are you going to take some heightened form of scrutiny and apply that to all laws? That's probably not likely. So then you're going to have to say, well, is it just those that are that conflict with an enumerated right in the Constitution, or are there unenumerated rights? And can you really get that out of the Constitution as an original matter? To what extent can you get? Which ones are the enumerated ones? So that would open a whole lot of new questions that nobody, except a few, you know, eggheads in their closets, seem to be interested in pursuing.
Steve, if I could, I was remiss at first. I want to also thank Katie and Matthew and their colleagues at the George Mason Law Review for the hospitality. You guys really have done a great job with the symposium. I know the issue will be a lot of fun to read, so thank you. And if I could exercise a prerogative to comment on this, I would say, look, it's no accident that the rational basis test is primarily applied in the setting of economic regulations because, as the Tenth Circuit said, and I have to read this again, dishing out special economic benefits to certain in-state industries is the favored pastime of state and local officials. And so it's a bit like, if a store is being looted during a riot and you go and ask the looters, you know, who are handing out stuff to their friends, would you have any problem getting rid of the blind policeman who's been on the block and having somebody who can actually see? Yeah, they'd have a problem with that, and for the exact same reason.
Any comments on this? We have time for, I think, one more question. Anybody, let me just, all right, David, you get, go ahead.
I just wanted to address Sandy's question about why state courts don't apply stricter scrutiny, and there are some states that do. But there's a very interesting piece, I forget where, I think it was published in the Minnesota Law Review by, I think it was Anthony Sanders' piece, who's an IJ Minnesota employee. And he went through the history of state court adjudication after the New Deal about how they handled economic regulation. And basically, through 1973, state courts did apply something akin to the Williamson versus Leopold lower court opinion that Randy mentioned, actually did fairly frequently say this law is just too arbitrary or doesn't have any good reason for it. And then we could guess what happened in 1973, which is Roe v. Wade. And basically, after Roe v. Wade, after this became sort of the great conservative cause to overturn Roe v. Wade, all the conservative state judges who had previously been willing to apply state due process clauses and other 14th Amendment-like provisions to adjudicate economic rights said, well, we don't, well, now we're afraid, you know, now people are accusing us of being like Roe, and we have to get rid of Roe, we can't, and this undermines things. And the liberal judges basically said, well, if the conservative judges aren't going to care about these economic rights, we're certainly not going to care. And suddenly a whole bunch of state courts that had previously engaged in fairly aggressive, you know, relative to Supreme Court review of economic regulations suddenly abdicated. And it's, one could say, yet another example of some of the effects that Roe has had, probably not positive on American jurisprudence.
Thank you. That's all the time we have.